Very good afternoon. I'm Shyam Kumar of third year BCom General Department. Now I take a privilege to welcome you all for this webinar titled Stock Market, conducted by Department of Commerce in association with Department of Training and Placement in Dhanaraj Bain Jain College. On behalf of DB Jain students, my sincere thanks to the management, our president, Sir Dayachand Savansukar sir, our secretary administration, Dr. Harish Mehta sir, secretary academic and finance, Sri Jashwant Munot sir, Professor in charge, Dr. M. Shaktivel Murugan sir, who has given all the support to conduct the webinars to students during this lockdown period. Now I welcome our chief guest, Mr. V. Krishnamurthy sir, Associate Vice President, Share Khan Limited, Chennai. He has 22 years of experience in stock market. He is into training for the last 5 years. He is a graduate from Vivekananda College. Currently, he is Vice President, taking care of advisory for business partners apart from training. We welcome you, sir, for our online webinar session. Now, I request Professor Vijaya Govindarajan, ma'am, to deliver the chief guest profiles. It's over to you, ma'am, now.
Welcome, sir. It's my privilege and honor to welcome Mr. Krishnamurthy to our DB Jain College. So, it's a honor and privilege. Please, you can take the dais, sir. As he has introduced yourself, you can start off with this, please.
Thank you.
And I also welcome Mr. Santosh of Share Khan to this webinar session.
Yes, ma'am. So I'd like to add before I start, first is Santosh and Vijaya ma'am has been instrumental in this, in bringing Share Khan to this board, and we thank them. And along with them, I would like to thank Aditi too. She's there in the as members, as participant. She's instrumental in preparing the entire presentation, long short of it. So thanks to her too. She's part of the participants. This thing. So now the Shyam pesina idella na naanga kuduthadhu dhaan. So adanalae adha vandu just take it with a pinch of salt. Okay. Now pandemic situation, or we call it testing times, pandemic times. This pandemic has thrown many of our life into a kind of a tizzy, has made us think of what reality is all about and how we have to ensure that no such situation, because it is unprecedented. We have never experienced such a situation before. None. Even our grandfathers have not experienced such situations of lockdowns, of such scenario. Despite all these, students, teachers, a big thanks to gurus in particular, because despite this testing times, they have ensured that education for the students' community doesn't come to a halt. As it's mentioned very clearly in DB Jain's tagline, education never stops, learning never stops. So they've all moved into virtual world. And with this virtual reality, we are adapting ourselves. Both gurus, both the teachers and students are adapting themselves to this online and virtual world. And still their classes are going on. But something, because we have been used to years of attending to classes, physical classes. Now this online virtual reality, I don't know to what extent it's going to make us comfortable. But still, we are adapting and moving ahead, going forward. But we only pray soon the vaccine is found and we are back to normal. Because what happens is, I'm sure gurus will also agree, it is very difficult for them to manage both home and office at home. That's a difficulty. Though they complete the job and go to office, for male it's okay, somehow they can manage, but still they find it very difficult. But for female, for women folk as such, it's been a very testing time. So we pray that soon the vaccine is found and we are back to normal. Though we are ready for the new normal. Now, let's get to what we wanted to learn today. I would like to share now. Can I? Is my screen, you're able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
As we can see.
What are we going to see today is, what's the stock market all about? And I'm sure that, is it possible that we can make it interactive, or is it quite difficult, right? Because if you unmute them, then we could have noise, right? across the background. Okay. So, stock market. What is the stock market? Stock market na enna? Eppadi nariya per therinjirukku. I think unga parents oda share certificate paathirupinga illa they would have opened a demat account. You must have got some experience to it, right? So I'm considering that you all have some idea about what stock market is all about. Let's see how the market functions. We're going to see the real screen too. I'll just share the real screen too of our platform so that you get an idea of how the market functions broadly. What is capital market? This is a place where instruments like bonds, equities, and mortgages get listed. And primary role is, you all know that there are companies which might need funding, which might need finance to run their enterprises. And that's where they form the deficit part. So who are going to contribute are people who have surplus money, which broadly everybody can save money. But today, the world over, or we follow the West. What the West follows is credit card culture. Without real money, having the real money on pocket, they spend through swiping credit cards. But largely Asian economies, by and large, particularly more so India, have been a savers economy. They've always been saving quite a lot. That's how our ancestors have been, and that's how we should always be. Despite the fact that we are moving, this generation is slightly moving towards less of saving. They go of the ideology that let's live rich rather than die rich. But the fact remains that this pandemic has opened their thought process, which indicates that there will be days when there'll be rainy days which they have to save from today. So unless and until they're going to save, it'll be very difficult for them to take care of their own future, be it retirement, be it planning for their kids' education, whatever. The different types of instruments that are traded in the capital market are equity instruments, which we're going to see today, credit market instruments, insurance instruments, hybrid instruments, and other derivative instruments. The nature of capital market, as I said, has multiple segments, deals in long-term securities. It has segments like equities, inequities, we have derivatives, we have commodities, we have currency. So multiple segments available in capital market, deals in long-term securities, by and large equities as such are long-term in nature. So if somebody wants to invest in equities, they have to think long-term and invest like as one asset class. We'll see how. Performs a trade-off function where if I'm a buyer, I would want to liquidate, sell and collect, mobilize cash for some other as investment in some other asset, then that trade-off function is being taken care by the capital market and creates dispersion in business ownership. How? For example, Reliance Industries, Dhirubhai Ambani is owning Reliance Industries. Can he alone be an owner and somebody wanted to part with him as an owner? And that is the place where they come out with an IPO. The companies come out with an IPO. We'll see what the primary market is all about. That's exactly where is the place where there is dispersion in ownership. And election capital formation. This is very vital. What we are seeing today, we're expecting government to spend, and the government is expecting the private sector to spend. Now, where will the private sector go for money? They will only have to raise money from people who save, who have money, who wants to invest money, just to make money work for them. Helps in creating liquidity. Now, as I said earlier, what happens when I own a share and I wanted to liquidate and I wanted to convert that into a cash? How do I do it? I need to have a standardized exchange, standardized marketplace where I can go anytime, liquidate the holding and convert those holdings into cash. So these are the two primary markets. This probably somebody who has been interested to know about what I've gone through by visiting the websites or probably the textbooks would have given you a basic idea of what this is all about, primary market and secondary market. Primary market largely deals with initial public offer, where the company comes out with the first time offer. The company comes out with the first time they want to raise money. And this is the place where the company raises money for what? To be invested. This money directly goes to the company, which is being utilized for various purposes. It could be either expansion, it could be either greenfield expansion, it could be brownfield expansion, it could be either buying machinery, capital investments, by and large. The companies will directly come into the market, the name of IPO, which is called New Issue Market, Initial Public Offering, because of which company will be able to raise funds and invest in their own business. Secondary market, this is a place where which is done through the exchange. This is the place where securities which come out of the IPO market or the primary market, the new issue market, gets listed here, and buying and selling. Wherein, for example, if I, as an investor, wanted to invest, I invest through an IPO. If I wanted to liquidate, where will I go and liquidate? I may have to open an account through a broker, through a secondary market. Secondary market is a process where we open an account and then liquidate the shares or buy new shares too. The chief purpose of the secondary market is to only create liquidity in securities. Now, in a tabular column, if you look at the basic differences between these two, primary and secondary market, the flow of funds is directed towards from savers to borrowers and industries. Industries, as I said, which may need money to expand. And secondary market, of course, primary market, money collected from this market is generally used by the companies to modernize plant, brownfield expansion, greenfield expansion, inorganic growth, whatever form they want to. So they would raise money directly. These IPO money, new issue market money, or primary market money directly goes to the company. Various methods of float capital issues, public issue, offer for sale, private placement, rights issue, and electronic initial public offering is in vogue now. The participants are merchant bankers who decide on the pricing, mutual funds, foreign institutional investors, FIIs, financial domestic institutional investors, financial investors, and individual investors. Secondary market, by and large, is a place where you buy and sell, which ensures the efficient price discovery. What is very important is by merely raising money, it's not sufficient. If the company keeps performing going forward, there is a price discovery that happens. Every investor who scrambles to buy in, who couldn't buy in the IPO market, who couldn't get allotment in the IPO market, or investors who were not in a position to subscribe to the IPO, would definitely scramble to buy through the secondary market, provided the company is performing well. Encourages efficient price discovery, because there's a scramble, there's a buyer, there's a seller, more buyers, and there is an easy entry and exit opportunity. What's very important is, as I said, liquidity plays. This liquidity and easy entry and exit are the two, both sets at the same point. Like, if I wanted to liquidate, and I'm able to liquidate in T plus two basis, and a settlement cycle is very less of a T plus two, on the third day, I will be able to receive the funds. So that is exactly when I wanted to buy, I need to transfer funds to the broker, and I will be able to get the share on a T plus three basis, on the third day, we'll get it. This is exactly what is automation has helped us. And participants here are the stock exchanges, mutual funds, FIIs, FIIs now called foreign portfolio investors and individual investors. Regulation. Now, before SEBI, we had controller of capital issues between 1988 and 1992. And then came SEBI, which is now, in fact, the regulator from 1992. In accordance with the Securities Exchange, SEBI is the regulator for capital market. And following are the acts, all these companies act, Controller of Capital Issues Act and Securities Contracts Regulation Act, all these three acts were brought into the fold of SEBI, and they started regulating in tandem. Because in 1991, you all could remember, probably Manmohan Singh was the finance minister at the time, Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao was the prime minister, who through opened the economy, wherein quite a lot of foreign institutional investors came into India, invested in India. That's exactly the reform, the biggest reform India had ever seen, the first set of reforms. Now, role of SEBI, what does SEBI? There are two roles SEBI plays. Securities and Exchange Board of India regulator plays. One is regulatory, ensures that stockbrokers, sub-brokers, mutual funds, self-regulatory organizations comply with the rules and regulations laid down by SEBI. Prohibition of all fraudulent and unfair trade practices, insider trading, and improved disclosures. Probably if you've been watching CNBC and ET now, there'll be quite a lot of disclosures by investors too, to the exchange, whenever a percentage of shares is bought by them. Developmental side, they resort to investor education and training of intermediaries and practices, and ensures a code of conduct, conducting research to ensure that investors do not get trapped on the wrong information available in the market. Yesterday, probably had you seen the television, there is a news speaker that was coming in, which saying that Mr. Tyagi is not happy because still funding requirement. Funding requirement is very less in terms of investor education, investor protection trust. In fact, he is trying to recommend more fund to be allocated to them so that they resort to invest education. They do quite a lot of programs across. Now that the pandemic forced them to stay, probably they do it through online too. So they resort to invest education. More sessions are being conducted, more seminars are conducted to ensure investors are well educated and well informed in terms of decision making. Who are the intermediaries, participants? Like stockbrokers, as I said, Sharekhan is another stockbroker. And there are registrars and transfer agents who resort to effecting the transfer of shares, and custodians and depositories. Custodians and by and large are people who hold shares for mutual funds, as mutual funds as a trust cannot hold shares in their name. And depositories, we're going to see from a few minutes from now. Stockbrokers are the people who are members of the we as a stockbroker, we are members of the exchange. We are intermediaries. We facilitate customers in buying and selling shares. Our registration. As per the SEBI regulations, it's very clear any client who wanted to deal with has to register with a broker like us and deal only through the exchange. And this registration is done by signing a KYC. Currently, we have eKYC because of this pandemic, where everything is done through online through Aadhaar link. And subject to confirmation of the eKYC, opening an account where all documentation will be transparent, after which there will be an account opened in your name, after which you can, through online or offline or by telephone, place orders to your broker and get confirmation through messages and through contract notes sent across the mail. So the system is completely transparent. Gone are those days when we had an open outcry system. What is change? Now this is a beautiful change. You almost definitely have thought about it. What is, probably somebody would have an opportunity, you could have seen this building we see in Dalal Street. This is the Bombay, is an exchange, is a place where it's a common platform where buyers and sellers get together to transact. Now, for example, if somebody is in Jammu and Kashmir, we do not know who the buyer is. If somebody is the buyer and somebody is a seller staying in Kanyakumari, they can transact together to transact by through online. Everything is completely automated. These pandemic times, there were only a few services which were unhindered. One of our industry is one our sector. In our sector, in the financial sector, we as one of the industry, we as a broking, as financial services, we have been, our business have been unhindered. The reason being, we were completely online. Completely online, wherein the buyer and the seller from any nook and corner of the country can transact and get together to transact. Systems prevalent before are open outcry, where you have to inform the broker, go physically, the broker will physically go to the exchange, will do an open outcry by shouting at some prices, and there will be a parallel broker who will also shout at some price. Once they get together and arrive at a particular price, that's how the trading was taking place. Now gone are those days. It was quite not transparent, it was opaque. We do not know what price the broker had committed and what price he's going to come to us. Now that it's all completely done, as we're doing everything through online, wherein you place a buy order, immediately there will be a confirmation right across your terminal. And then at the end of the day, you will get a message, your registered mobile number, and also a contract note sent across through mail, your registered mail ID. And why a stock exchange? Now, this definitely would be a question in your mind, because we need to standardize the entire operation and process. Because I, as an individual, if I'm going to commit something and I don't honor your commitment, then where will you go as a seller? So these are questions that are lingering. So they said there'll be an exchange which is standardized form, wherein they link people who have surplus money with groups of people who need it. A stock exchange is simply an efficient way of shuffling around society's resources, and each, so that, as I said before, that we are building wealth. If you want to build wealth, you have to be part and be an owner of a company which is going to generate income and also wealth. Generate income in the form of dividend and wealth. For example, Lens Industries was trading at 100 rupees, 150 rupees in 2000, 2500 rupees in 2000, 2003. Now it's trading at 2000 rupees. So if you want to build wealth, you need to be part. You need to be an owner. Part owner, and you become an owner. How you can become an owner? If you invest in equity shares. Now, each transaction has three main players. One is the shareholder, the company, and the stockbroker who facilitate and advise on the handing over of money. The stock exchange makes it all formal and legal, allowing share purchases and sales to be recorded and settled. This is the important facet. Now, how it is guaranteed is by the eliminating the counterparty risk. You'll see which are all the entities within the exchange which is guaranteeing settlement. There are two exchanges available currently. One is National Stock Exchange, NSE, and other one is BSE, Bombay Stock Exchange. Bombay Stock Exchange is the oldest exchange. NSE started in 1995. Bombay Stock Exchange started in 1985. One of the biggest boards in terms of listing and market capitalization. Institutional brand is synonymous. Now, like if somebody wanted to look at, if some foreign investors, foreign institutional investors, or we call it foreign portfolio investors, whoever invests in money, they look at BSE and NSE as one parameter. And across the world, even when we are investing, general perception is when we see the news, we see that BSE, whether Sensex has gone up, whether Nifty has gone up. Now who is guaranteeing this settlement, clearing and settlement? Bank of India, shareholding, boy shareholding in BSE, is guaranteeing settlement, clearing and settlement. And Sensex is the benchmark equity index. We call them index. We'll see what this Sensex is all about. And how the Sensex sensitive index is called Sensex, and how it is arrived at is sum of free float capital by base capital into 100. And sum of free float capital is from total current market capitalization to free float cap factor. This is just for knowledge purposes, you can have it. And base market capitalization is 1978-79. Base market capital is 100. So once you do this math, you will get this Sensex value. We'll see that. I'll share the screen too with you. So these are the Sensex comprises of 30 stocks representing various sectors. Because why this is ensured that every sector is represented here. So when I say Sensex has gone up, it is under the assumption that across the board, there is a broad rally that has taken place. There is a very high possibility where index heavyweights, like for example, HDFC or Reliance might go up, rest of the stocks might fall down, but still we talk of a broader rally in the Sensex, that the Sensex gone up. So this is representing all varied. Sensex comprises of 30 stocks representing varied sectors across. And if you look at the Sensex return from 2000 till date, Sensex, it was 3972 in 2000. I'm saying the closing price, and today till date is 42,275, which is yielding an absolute return of 924%. If somebody invested, of course, directly, you will not be able to invest in Sensex. You will have to invest in Sensex stocks comprising of 30, or probably take an exposure derivative where you directly buy into a Sensex futures and hold on to it for long term. So on a long term, I'm saying last 20, then an absolute return of 920%. Now, what is NSE? NSE was incorporated. NSE was in fact instrumental in the pioneer in automated trading, completely automated trading, wherein terminals were given to brokers. And now these brokers like us, we are giving online terminal. So like if a customer opens an account, we have a platform through which they can place orders sitting at their own pace or through the laptops and systems. So this NSE commenced operations in 1994, introduced a screen-based trading nationwide, and National Securities Clearing Corporation, boy shareholding for BSE, and NSECL to eliminate counterparty risk, which means that if as a buyer, I buy in a share and I don't honor the payment, then it's duty of the counterparty, NSECL as a clearing corporation, to clear it off, both pain and also securities. If I'm selling and not honoring giving the shares for delivery, then NSECL would buy in the auction market and debit the person who has defaulted on payment. Brought in debt market, there is a wholesale debt market available in the NSE platform too. So we are not members there. Derivative instruments though is available. And Nifty is the benchmark. National 50 is Nifty, is the benchmark as far as NSE is concerned. Again, Nifty also same sum of free float capital. This free float capital based methodology is being deployed across most of the countries. West, US follows it. Germany, Europe follows it by and large. So total market capitalization to free float cap factor is what again is the formulae. And the base market capital, here the base market capital for Nifty is 1,000. So that needs to be kept in mind. So again, Nifty comprises of 50 stocks, now 51. Tata Motors DR is also added to it. So Sensex has 30 stocks, limited to 30. Nifty has 51 stocks, so it's 50 now. One DVR is added to it now. But again, as I said, this Nifty 51 stocks represents varied sector. So each and every sector has a representation in the index, both Sensex and Nifty. Nifty returns also. Is absolute return of 953%. 1180 was the price in 2000. Now it's 12,000 and bar roughly. It did touch a high of 12,430. Now, how are stocks selected in these indices? That's another important facet. How 30 of, you know, within the 30 stocks, how if in IT, if I say IT, why, how come Infosys is selected? How come it's Wipro is selected? Now, these are the three important criteria that's being kept. One is liquidity. It should be, I should be as an investor or a trader, I should be able to buy and sell anytime I want to, which means I should be good amount of volume. Again, if there are good amount of volume, market capitalization. When there is a good market capitalization, only liquidity would be there. So higher the market capitalization, there is a very high chance. Market capitalization is nothing but the number of equity shares available in the market into price. So when there are more participation, definitely market capitalization would go up. Sector representation. So each and every sector, the stocks should represent each and every. Every sector should have representation in the index. That's the key criteria that's being kept. By depositories. Now, before, I'm saying before 99, this liberalization process, what was happening is every buy or a delivery based buy, the delivery would take 1 month to be effected. Meaning, therefore, if I'm buying in a Reliance share today, it will take 1 month for me to get the share certificate in my account or get it to me physical shares. So now this is completely done away with. When the economy was thrown open, we have to match the global standards. Matching the global standards, in the process of matching the global standards, what we did is we automated everything. We brought in a new settlement. We'll see what the settlement is all about so that you will get a better picture of it. So by bringing in depositories, which means depositories there are two depositories. One, depositories are the entities which are going to hold shares in their name, the company's book. So if I'm a shareholder, I will be called a beneficial owner. So in the company's book, it will be depositories and beneficial owners are investors and traders like us. Why it is done? Longer period of share transfer to be effected, as I said, and bad deliveries. That be physical shares when we're dealing with, there is every problem that it gets mutilation would be there, and then there'll be a theft or a forgery. So all these problems were completely done away with this automation so that there's no physical physical shares being dealt in with. What is a depository? Depository is an organization which holds securities like shares, debentures, bonds, government securities, mutual fund units, etc. of investors in electronic form at the request of the investors through a registered depository participant like us. We at Sharekhan, also one of the depository participants, also provide services related to transactions and securities. So anybody who wanted to buy in a share, they would get the shares in electronic form in their own. We call it beneficial owner account through a depository participant. Like a bank account, they will get a statement anytime, whenever they want. Since everything is online, they can do the statement anytime. An analogy is drawn here between a bank and a depository. A bank which holds funds in your account, right? Like we are just holding an account in any bank, the funds are kept by a bank. No problem, the funds are safe. Similarly, depositories hold securities in an account, in your account, in our account. Transfer funds between accounts, online fund transfer happens. Transfer securities can be done when you sell in a share. That is, when you open an account with Sharekhan, what happens? You open along with the DP account, which is called deposit participant account. As a beneficial owner, when you sell, automatically there's a power of attorney getting executed, wherein automatically your shares will get honored. So you don't need to bother about your honor of securities after selling it. Facilitates in bank a facility transfer without any handling of money. Similarly, facility transfer of ownership without handling securities. Like physical securities, there's a problem. Theft, forgery, all these issues are completely done away with. Facilities, safekeeping of money. Facilitates, safekeeping of money. Money, again, depositories, completely safe. Even if a depository participant shuts, even if a broker shuts, he is duty bound to transfer to other depository participant wherever you open an account, and there is a form to be filled and given by the investor or the trader, after which the shares will be transferred to the respective account. So it ensures that safekeeping of securities. Which are the depositories available in India? One is NSDL and CDSL, promoted by NSE. This is CDSL, promoted by BSE. So again, owners are banks, an array of banks, SBI to HDFC Bank to Canara Bank, as far as NSDL is concerned. Again, in CDSL too, there are a whole host array of banks for owners of CDSL and NSDL. Depository participants, as I said, we, of course, Carvey is not rendering services, stock holding corporation is another depository. Almost all banks are depository participants. Settlement cycle, how this takes place? As I said, trading, when you buy a share, today being Thursday, I buy a share, automatically on Monday evening or latest by Tuesday morning, I will get my shares provided that the payment for the shares is done with the broker. Now, T plus two is a settlement cycle for cash market, and derivatives is T plus one. Wherein I buy today, next day I may have to settle. Settlement for auction market is 5 days. Now, there is every possibility that the person who has sold the shares has not honored, or without the shares he has sold, then it goes to the auction market exchange, as I told you, through NSECL, goes to the auction market, buys in the share and honors the commitment that is due for us. This is how the entire settlement cycle works. So buying broker's account, buyer's DP account, going to the buying broker's pool account, and then to the selling broker's pool account through seller's DP to the seller. This is how entire settlement cycle works. Again, juxtaposing multiple positions, multiple trade, and off-market transfers, clearing corporation comes into the picture, seller to the buyer, seller to the DP. So multiple transactions are possible through this settlement cycle. What are the different types of order? One is the market order, the limit order, and stop loss trigger price. Market order is, let me just get to this, to our platform. Is my screen visible? Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you are able to see the platform. See, our platform is this. This is how the market functions. You can see on the top, and I'm using my mouse cursor here. This is Nifty. We saw that. The next is Sensex. See how the prices are getting updated. These are the Nifty stocks, Nifty 50 stocks, out of which ACC, I'm clicking on it. You can see the buyers and sellers, how the rates are getting updated, how buyers and sellers need to transact, get to transact, and probably they scramble for buying and selling based on whatever the value of the script pertains to on that particular day. This is how the screen will look like. So the moment you open an account, our platform, through this platform, you can have a view of how this market functions. You all get a view of how this works. See, one suggestion to all, you all probably, next year they are all out of college, right, ma'am? So that's how the screen looks like. This is how Nifty and Sensex are. So you need to experience it. As undergraduate, you get an opportunity to open an account with us. Shekhar, I'm not just marketing. It's just for knowledge purpose. You need to open an account, get an idea how this functions basically, so that you get a feel of it. And the moment you are serious about investing, the moment you get surplus money, you should start investing, investing through. Now, what we are seeing is various types of order. One is the market order. The other one is the limit order. Market order is I wanted whatever the market price is, I want to execute it immediately, is the term that we given as a market order, where if I select a market order, then price will get executed. But whatever the price that's available in the market. Limit order is when I place in a limit, particular price. For example, if the current price is 100 and I want to buy it at 90 rupees and I place it at 90 rupees, it remain pending till the price comes down to 90 rupees and then the order gets executed. Stop loss or trigger price. This is normally the term used by traders largely to ensure that they don't lose more money. What happens now? I buy in a share for 100 rupees and I place a stop loss at 90 rupees so that I will not be able to bear loss more than 90 rupees. So the moment the price hits 90 rupees, the stop loss gets triggered. I don't lose my capital. Only 10 rupees or whatever I will lose. Trading. What does trading mean? It's just the mere buying and selling of shares on the same day. Market starts at 9:15. From 9:15 to 3:30, whatever the trade that we do, whatever buying and selling we do, but we have to square off within that day, that's called trading on the same day. Any buy and sell that is done on the same day it's called, that comes under trading. All trades are settled within a day and no carry forward of any trades. Selling shares without owning shares, short selling is allowed. I was telling you before that any particular customer who is going to, anybody who is going to sell in the share, they're supposed to honor by giving in delivery of the shares that they've bought. What happens currently is everything is, power of attorney is executed wherein automatically the shares are honored through their respective demat DP account. So the moment customer does not have a DP account or does not own share in a DP account, I'm sorry, does not own share in a DP account, then probably he sells it. That's called short selling. He has to ensure that he is going to buy it back on the same day before the market closes at 3:30. Trader, what kind of a return? Normally, this traders should expect a very high return because this is a bit risky. High return, the sense aims to get higher than 20%. See, because risk is high, but you can't expect a very higher margin because within the, there is a time constraint. There is a time constraint where no, between 9:15 and 3:30, we're supposed to square up the trade. In which case, the possibility that the prices not go as expected. So in which case margin should be less, but they expect a higher return where they can be taking a higher risk going forward. And they should be highly, they should be comfortable with volatility and leverage. Markets are going to be volatile. There will be, that's exactly why I told you stop loss is very important, because when markets are volatile, to ensure that you don't lose more money and ensure that only a percentage of whatever the percentage of your capital is risk at that point in time. And what does trading mean? It's nothing but battle between bulls and bears. A bull is a person who is expecting the market to go. Bear is a person who is expecting the market to come down or the price of a particular share to come down. So there's a tug of war between a bull and a bear. And end of the day, whoever wins, when the price goes up, it's the bulls. Bulls are the winners. And if the price has come down, bears are the winners. So there'll be two participants. We might also be a bull or a bear. We might also have a view. It depends on our view. Today I might be a bull, tomorrow I might be a bear. So every individual, there is no particular sect as bulls, there is no particular sect as bears. Everybody would keep changing their colors based on the market. Investment. What is, how it is different from trading? Trading, as I said, you have to buy in and buy in the morning and sell in the evening before the market closes. Whereas in an investment, buying in a share and selling it on a later date. So I'm going to buy today, for example, on a Thursday, and I'm going to sell either tomorrow or sell on Monday or sell on Tuesday or sell on any other day other than the same day, then it's called investment oriented trading. We give in a different term for that. We call it swing trading if I'm going to do it within 2-3 days, within 5 days. But normally investment is a term used only for long term, which means I'm going to buy in today, I'm going to hold for a year or so, year more than a year or so. So that's exactly what investment is all about as a term. So buy in today, sell on any other day after the same day. So investor normally expects a very, they're conservative, very low to medium risk return, and they would expect a return of 10 to 12%, 12 to 13%. Long term investor, the returns could be sky high. This is just an expected return. Returns could be sky high. Difference between investing and trading. In a tabular form, holding period 1 day to few weeks. That's why I said trading could be either 1 day or could be few weeks, which we call it swing trading. In investing, it could run through years, months and years. Time, continuous tracking of market is very important. Occasional price checkups. No, what happens in investing is if I do the ground properly, if I fundamentally very strong stock and just keep buying, hold on to it, returns have been phenomenal. Returns, as I showed you a chart wherein the Nifty returns in the last 20 years have been, absolute return has been 900%. So you hold on to a quality stock, they keep outperforming, and then the returns are phenomenal. Cost, generally trading costs higher because there are more transactions done. Investing, wherein you buy in a year, if you buy, make 2-3 investments or 5-6 investments, then that cost would come down substantially. It would be very less rather. Risk involved is very higher as far as trading is concerned. Here, risk involved is lower. Returns are very high, should expect a very high return because again, we are involved. There is a time constraint. So with that expectation, expecting a very high return, you should also be ready for a high volatility and high risk too. As far as investing is concerned, you need to wait. Risk is quite a bit high, provided if we can do proper homework in investing, it's done properly. Short-term liquidity, yes. And there is, if you wanted to sell in share, and I say that I will not be, if, since I'm not going to do intraday trading, that liquidity part might be less here, where I need to wait for at least 2 days if you want to liquidate my investments, at least 2-3 days. Whereas in intraday, I can square off on the same day. and just get the money back. So there are products available with us called BigTrade. That's exactly what's mentioned there. So there are corporate actions being announced across the companies. So what happens? Companies comes out with the bonus. That's nothing but shares gifted by the company to the shareholders, liquidity issues. Now, why the company comes out with bonus? Because the price could be higher. And by coming out of the bonus, the company is expecting more retail investors to participate, or the company is unable to distribute dividend, they are announcing bonus shares. In fact, share price will fall in proportion to the bonus shares, where if I'm going to issue a company and issues 1:1 bonus, then the price of the share should be halved. That's the point that they mentioned here. Indication companies good health, and obviously you can see returns of Infosys Wipro. Quite a lot of quality companies who have been announcing quite a lot of many number of bonuses to splits. Only to ensure them, revealing that the company is performing very well. Rights issue again. This is another corporate action wherein the company raises money from existing shareholders. Share price is given to the existing shareholders an option to invest at a discounted price. So that is again plowed back by the company whenever the company wants to. As I told you, this money, rights issue money, also directly goes into the company's coffers, which will be used for company's own investment purposes. Stock split, as I told you, in bonus prices, if the price is very high, they should know the small investors also participate by splitting from 10 to 2 or 10 to 5. So that price will also get halved and more number of people will participate. And dividend, as you all know, when you own a share, the company wants to reward the shareholders, they pay dividend. Currently, this year, they have started taxing dividend too, because it was tax-free. Buyback, now many number of IT companies come out with a buyback offer. TCS and Wipro buyback offer is in vogue. So they buy it back because they wanted to, one, reward the shareholders, and number two, they feel their share price currently is less and they wanted to buy it back. And this is the time they want to buy it back, or probably the company wanted to put their cash availability efficiently. And there are two types of analysis when you talk of markets. One is fundamental analysis, the other one is technical analysis. Fundamental analysis by and large speaks of fundamental values of the company, which creates long-term values for the three part. One is the economy, industry, and the firm, which is called the top-down approach, is what is being deployed here. Fundamental analysis appeals primarily to long-term investors. When I talk about economy, how is the economy functioning, then industry, and then the firm, primarily only to long-term investors. Fundamental analysis, by and large, is for long-term investors who have a better vision, better view. They look at the company, they look at the economy, they look at the industry sector in which the company is, for example, IT, look at industry, how the sector as such is performing, and then look at the companies like Infosys, TCS, Wipro. Economy-wide factors, what are these? Are all, in fact, these are all largely theoretical in basis. Since you guys are undergraduates, the moment you pursue next year, PG, or probably you want to work through, you will be reading through a book by name Mr. Krishna Chandra, who will talk about all these economy-wide factors by and large. But the beauty of this industry is it has direct linkage with the whatever is really happening in the economy. Whatever really is happening, whatever you're reading through, you can monitor, you can just gaze through, you can just infer many things practically too. One is economy-wide factors, the growth rate, the GDP, the savings and investments, government budget and deficit, price level. So this is one industry which gets you, investment as such is an industry which gets you, it's a sector which gets you quite a lot of knowledge, which has complete relevance, unlike other education system, other education platform, like it's completely root-based. And whatever you study, it might not have any kind of a direct linkage of what the job that you do here. Whatever you study in this Prasanna Chandra's book, you will have a lot of correlation to whatever you're witnessing or whatever you're experiencing. So government and budget deficit, interest rate, price level and inflation, infrastructure facilities and arrangements, these are the economy-wide factors that are going to have a bearing. Industry-wide factors, industry life cycle analysis of the sector performs, of the sector's growth prospects going forward are within the sector. Because now, small example I can give you is how disruption is taking place currently. What we saw was a lot of office spaces being used and rentals being high and skyscraper buildings were there. But now, probably you could have gone through the newspaper, in Bangalore, a lot of companies are shutting shop and trying to move to a model of work from home. So we need to look at how the real estate is going to perform going forward. Is it something which is going to be in stay put, or this is going to change the dynamics of the industry? So industry life cycle structure, study and structure of the current, this is exactly what needs to be understood, studied. Profit potential of industries needs to be looked into. Company-wide factors, When we talk of company-wise, it's again return on equity or dividend payout, how the company has performed, growth performance, XCAGR, how P/E ratio, how the company has performed. So these are all based on balance sheet and profit and loss account, various ratios with which we decide whether this company is worth investing, whether there is a return on capital employed, higher return on equity, and the return on equity in ROCMP sustained. So these are questions that you can learn or you can just get through these factors. Other factors are availability of cost inputs, technological production capabilities, marketing and distribution, finance and human resources. All these are important points need to be looked into when you go in for a fundamental investment. Technical analysis broadly a short term in nature, wherein it depends on technical analysis as such is largely depending on demand and supply, which means that based on volume data. So it's completely based on buyers and sellers, short term traders who decide on what how the prices would be in short term, how they have to react because they have their margins less, so they try to buy in and try to make the buy in and market and try to sell in probably with a lesser margin since the risk is high. Now, various studies are available now. Based on your interest, you can pursue all these price versus volume change, advanced decline ratio, Elliott wave channel, trending patterns, and MACDs. These are all probably maybe a week in Latin for you all. You can take and learn through. The sources are available. What we do in Sharekhan is once you open an account, there is a Sharekhan classroom through which you can attend to all the basics. We have from basic to the advanced topic being covered across. So you can, based on your interest, learn each and every video is available for customers and learn through them. There is a recording available for the last conducted session. There's a live session available. Based on your interest, you can develop because very important is not only earning money, but also how well you put your money to work by one earning and two saving and three investment. So this is one asset class which you can't scuttle going forward. Our ancestors have been scuttling through. Somewhere they were getting returns of 10%, 11%, 9%, 8% on fixed deposits. Now gone are those days, interest rates are completely down. The secured investments, the returns have been not, it's not going to be good. It's not going to get back your 9%, 8%, 9% band. It can over to 7% probably. Even there, having said this now, can we put all the money, all the egg in the single basket and put all your money in equities? That's not the right way of looking at. We need to diversify our portfolio based on the age. This is something that needs to be kept in mind, but equities cannot be scuttled. Equities cannot be shied away from. Sensex, if you look at why invest in equities, as we saw, we saw the chart too, wherein the returns have been close to absolute returns have been phenomenal in the last 20 years. So how are we supposed to take part in by only participating equities? Now there is a general talk that Indian economy is going to grow and India would be competing China going forward with the government's initiatives and all those stuff. How are we supposed to participate in this India's growth story? If we wanted to participate in the India growth story, we need to be part of equities because otherwise we will not be able to make money out of India growth story. Being Indians, if you're not able to participate in India growth story and make money out of it, there's no point. So why capital market and economy? We've discussed all these in length before. Economic individual, we should participate. That's exactly what the key wanted to highlight here. Now, why invest? See, very important thing that needs to be kept in mind is inflation. The price rise is something which cannot be avoided. Prices are rising. Inflation data being announced by this statistical organizations are not something which you can really go by, though that is being kept as a parameter. What we need to look at is how the prices of our basic milk has gone up in the last 33 years. So that is something which is very important because prices are set to rise. How are we supposed to guard against? One second. So this is to be kept in mind, inflation. So inflation, the rise in inflation, how are we supposed to keep our investments or savings inflation proof to ensure that whatever the money that we save is invested properly in right asset class and that in asset class yields returns better than which is able to with which we're able to beat inflation. That needs to be kept in mind. What now this pandemic has thrown open many of the lingua franca, where we call pandemic proof, inflation proof and pandemic proof. proof. So this is something, probably once till the vaccine is found and with the recency effect, you will not forget this for at least a couple of years, and then afterwards we'll tend to forget it. What's very important is, we need to ensure that our investment is inflation proof, where the returns are inflation proof going forward. Now, why invest? So beyond a point, at this, when we start saving money and investing money at the very young age, because now that after 60, we will not be able to work. We will not be able to work like you worked at 30, 40, at 60. So what is very important is, we have to ensure money as the money works for us. So we need to ensure that whatever the money that we save, we invest it, and the money starts making money. That's exactly the idea. That's the thesis with which we need to work on. Investment return should beat the inflation, which ensures that we will at least maintain the purchasing power. You want to maintain the same standard of living going forward, or tomorrow after 10 years, after 20 years, the prices, since the prices are going up, it has a compounding effect on our money. This is one important, this is an important slide. This is an example which you can look at, where impact of inflation, which how it eats money, the value of money erodes. So monthly expenses of 30,000 in the same standard of living, after 20 years, you need 80,000 plus, but our value of investments will come down, erodes. So this is the key that needs to be kept in mind, because value of money erodes with the kind of return potential, with less return potential available. So that needs to be kept in mind. So again, RBI's comfort zone, 4.5%, 6% are all okay, but still our real cost of living is much more than what we're seeing. So we can't rely on it, and prices are likely to not be constant. So this equity remains the best asset class. So enna mukkiyamaana vishayam paakanona, the thanks to tutors, gurus, professors who have taken this initiative, because in the investor education, financial literacy, this is a project being pursued by central bankers. Even Reserve Bank of India does it, SEBI does it. Children in the school, from the school, they are supposed to teach children on the financial literacy aspect. So very important. This is an excellent initiative. Friends, I think this session, after this session, this should be an eye-opener, where you start looking at it, because this age would not entail, but you have to keep in mind that this is the time that you start looking at it, learning many, many things, so that when you start earning money, that day one you start earning money, you need to save to ensure that you're completely safeguarded from any of the ill effects of inflation or pandemic or whatever, because nothing is sure. Completely, the entire thing is getting disrupted. Job losses. I don't know whether we'll be able to work till 60, or we'll be interested to work till 60. So there are people who wanted to get retire at 45 and do their own passion. So if you want to do it, you have to start early of investing or whatever, saving first and then invest. So equities has always remained the best asset class. We will be able to share all these details. Once, my request to you all is, open an account, learn, visit the site, learn many things. Just start investing with small amount, understand how the system works, how this particular stock market works, functions, and how particular transaction gets affected, so that later stage, when you make money, when you earn money, it'll be easy to be a cakewalk of investing. So that's the introduction of what Sharekhan is all about. We are a premium broking company. In fact, Santosh, our OMR branch manager, will be there. His number is available with ma'am. You can get in touch with him, open an account, get an idea of what this is all about. And this is the right time. You can spend time on educating yourself, and then probably at the time when you're comfortable and confident, you can start investing in the market directly. And that's it from now, from me, ma'am. I'm just, let me just hand over. Jaya, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Over to Shamini for word of thanks.
Very good afternoon. I'm Shamini from third year BCom General. On behalf of DB Jain College, it was indeed a privilege to have Mr. V. Krishnamurthy, sir, Associate Vice President, Sharekhan Limited, Chennai. His insightful lecture about title stock market was extremely informative. Once again, I thank you, sir, for sharing us your knowledge and having spread your precious time for all of us. I express my profound gratitude to our management professor in charge, Dr. Shaktivel Murugan, sir. Program conducted by Department of Commerce and Department of Placement and Training for organizing such a thought-provoking session. Thank you all once again for the success of today's online webinar session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, and God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Yes, thank you so much, sir.
Sir, you have given a very glimpse of entire share market, right from the basic to intraday trading. You have covered all the aspects in a very minimum time, sir. What you have learned over the period of 20 years, you have given it in a very small and very bird's eye view of the entire stock market operation. We have got a very good knowledge about all these things, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And kudos to each guru.